when I put on my glasses. My name's Gary Tomlinson, and I've had the honor to introduce our update lecturer for, this is the 8th year. Yeah, and for those who don't know, and don't know what's coming, new members, you have to have a seasoned member explain this to you, but I've known Ron for most of his life, if you can call that a life. So I decided to tell you what Ron means to me. Friend, confidant, lover. Oh wait, this is wrong screen. Wait a second. Where was it? What Ron means to me. One word can sum it up in a nutshell. Be nice.
Thank you.
Nice. You don't know how hard that is. That one word is Kaychuk. K-A-I-T-C-H-U-C-K. Kind, amazing, intelligence, teacher, cunning, homogeneous. Unforgettable, cosmic, and knowledgeable. That's what Ron means to me. Yes, kind. He's the kind of guy you wish you'd never met. Amazing. It's amazing how he's got us all fooled and thinking we know what he's talking about. Intelligence, or lack thereof. He even makes Donald and Hillary look good. Teacher. Ron is a perfect teacher, an example we all should use as to what not to do. Cunning. It takes a lot of cunning to pull off what he does. Homogeneous. Same bowl top to bottom. Unforgettable. Yes, he is indeed unforgettable. Cosmic. He's very cosmic. Mostly empty space. Knowledgeable. Well, I do have to give that to him. He really does know what he's talking about. So let's listen to Ron talk. Ladies and gentlemen, Dr. Ronald H. Kaychuk.
You know, I haven't been using a cane that long, but I've gotten pretty good with this. right there. This is not an easy talk to do. The way it works is tomorrow, literally, I start collecting topics for next year. This goes on throughout the whole year. I get emails, I get things on listservs, I get, you know, this and that, copy links, whatever, and create a large file folder on my desktop, which is possible topics for next GLPA. And then I have to look them over, you know, a month or two out of the meeting and start putting together the talk you're about to hear. Sounds straightforward. I had the worst time ever this time because I opened that folder they've been accumulating all year and there were 64 topics. So if I go one every 30 seconds without taking a breath, I can get them all done. Now, of course, I'm going to have to pick and choose. This first topic is related to this concept, matter, antimatter. You've heard this before, you know, matter. We usually talk about this in terms of little elementary particles. So the matter would be things like protons and electrons, and antiparticles are just the opposite of each one of those in every way you can think of. Charge is reversed, you know, spin is reversed, and other quantum properties. In other words, the antimatter is really, really extremely different. Well, that got me thinking about this. There's still time to talk. Well, there's Gary.
Huh?
And here's the anti-Gary. And the way this ties to talk is 100 years ago, this young guy, young at the time, in his 20s, proposed general relativity. Now, when you and I cover this, I include myself in this, we work a lot with analogies, and we try to make it so we can kind of figure out and visualize this. He didn't need all that. This was based on mathematics. Well, I'm good at math, but not that good. I can follow a lot of it, but not all of it. So, his general relativity talked about what gravity was all about, but it also predicted gravity waves. Now, he also mentioned that they would never be detected. Never is a bad word to use sometimes. He was wrong. Because 100 years ago, after 100 years, it's happened. The first indirect measurement was just that. But I give you some little background first. General relativity, GR, space's properties. We think of space as a vacuum and it has nothing to it. His genius was, no, there's something to this. It has properties. That's still going to be a little hard for me to get across to you in just a few minutes. But one of the properties is it can have curvature. Sort of like a big top can have curvature. And time, this thing we think of as being rigid and always flowing in one direction at a nice even pace because that's our everyday experience, is also tied to space. So, the two are tied together, and together they can be thought of as analogous to a fabric. And we use these kind of ideas to explain gravity, for instance, as being a curvature of space, space-time actually, created by a mass. Now remember, I said space-time, so yes, space is distorted, but so is time. Now, we like to use these 2D analogies. You know, here's this bowling ball sitting on a bedspread. You put a bowling ball on the bedspread, the bed will indent because the ball is massive. You take a tennis ball and try to roll it by, and it doesn't go in a straight line. It's kind of deviated by the dent in the bed. In fact, if you do it just right, and you don't have too much friction, if you throw the ball just the right way, that tennis ball, it will go around a complete loop. Guess what? It orbits. And so this is his way of thinking about gravity. Now, the way I was introduced to gravity, and maybe you were introduced to gravity, is through Newton's law of gravity, you know, force equals gm1 m2 over d squared. I hope you know that Newton was very dissatisfied with that equation. Because it described the strength of the force, it never explained where it came from. And maybe that's bothering you too. Well, notice how in that grid there on the bed top, bedspread out, can you see my mouse coming? Mouse cursor coming in there? No, that doesn't work on here. Okay, yeah. That's going to be a little tough later. You might notice that those intervals, the grid are stretched as you're going toward the bowling ball. Well, guess what? Time is another dimension in space-time, and it gets stretched too. So when you get closer to a massive object, an interval of 1 second actually now is longer to someone who's watching this from a distance like you are now in this diagram. So time's a thing. Okay, heavy-duty stuff. We don't have time to go through a whole lot of this, but gravitational waves. Well, if you got this fabric in the bin, if you have some kind of commotion from a massive object, you create waves. Like something splashing upon. And that should be detectable, you would think. Well, not really, because it's so small. And that will tell you how much. And the object that's splashing around or moving around to create the waves is actually propagating out energy. It's losing energy. So I show two little black hole-like things going around. But since they're creating these waves in space-time, which we have this little flat analogy of, 2D analogy, they're actually losing energy. So it had been proposed some time ago that that might be a way to indirectly see gravitational waves. The binary pulsar, see the number there, that's both its declination and right ascension numbers, basically. was in a tight orbit, massive stars. And so it looked like, if you watch this thing, if it's losing energy, gravitational waves, those two stars should be spiraling tighter and tighter and closer together. And because they go around so quickly, and they're pulsars, which means we can measure timing with millisecond precision, we might be able to see it. Now, you don't have to know the details of this plot, that the vertical axis is the rate of change in the spin period of these things. And you got time across the horizontal axis in years. You can see the dots, you see the curve. The curve is from general relativity. It goes right through the observation. This was a Nobel Prize. But it's indirect. We want to see this stuff directly. And that's what's happened. I'm starting with this because I cannot possibly overestimate or over-exaggerate to you, overemphasize to you how important this is. And it doesn't seem like it so much yet. Give it a few years. The Laser Interferometer Gravity Wave Observatory, LIGO, shortly after it went to full precision, full resolution, came online, and just at the end of the test phase, almost immediately detected gravitational waves. Now, in this picture, which I can't point to, but I guess I can't use that, those are two arms, one stretching out to the distance, one going across horizontally. Each one of those is several miles long. And going through those tubes are laser beams. And I'm not going to go through the details of this picture, but the idea is, by sending light down those long tubes, in fact, they'll actually let it go back and forth several times. That's what the partially reflected mirrors are about. So we get several laps, and this thing, each arm's 2.5 miles. What they do is they can tell from the interference pattern if those waves in the two arms are coming back together at the same time. They ought to, they're going to speed of light, the length's the same, it should always arrive. But basically you can tell, detect very slight differences. If the length of the arm, because space itself is being distorted and then takes everything else with it, then in fact, we should see this go out of phase. Using this interference of light is a really sensitive way to measure things. Well, in fact, that's what was discovered. Now, as you might imagine, a lot of things can cause things to stretch. And, you know, how about earthquakes? You know, all kinds of things. Well, they have to be desensitized with all that stuff, be able to discount it. You do that by having two observatories, two of these LIGOs, one's in Louisiana, one's in Washington State, and you can see those curves. What's the vertical axis? This is just sort of like the stretching, if I think of that, of the length of the arms versus time, and that's just in fractions of a second. The blue curve is from one observatory, it's from the Livingston, and the brown curve is from Hannover, and they lay right on top of one another. Can't do that with seismic events. So what could it be? Oh, by the way, how much did it actually change? The length of the arm is 4 kilometer arms, 2.5 miles. They changed about the width, well, thousands actually, the width of a proton. I repeat, the length over 2.5 miles changed 1/1000th the width of a proton. Now you know why Einstein said we'd never do this. And it's been done. Even that's amazing, let alone what it tells us. Well, to interpret all this, you need models based on general relativity. And the one that fits indicates what they may have seen was the death spiral. Two large black holes spiraling into one another and merging. In fact, they just saw the last few orbits. What masses? Well, they work out in within that curve, 29, 36 solar masses. Not a hefty black hole. Coming back to that, it's actually something odd about those numbers. Estimate of the distance, and I'll be frank with you, I have not yet quite got my handle on how they got that number of 1.3 billion light years. Whole thing was less than a second, and it turns out the model tells you the mass after merger, and it also tells you the mass before merger. And guess what? Three solar masses disappeared. It went into energy. A lot of energy. At peak power, the output was 50 times that of the entire rest of the universe. But it was in gravitational waves. I don't think any of you noticed it. No. That kind of energy, that kind of power, didn't last long, but it was there. Oh, by the way, they detected another one. Smaller black holes, 14 to 8 times the mass of the sun. They had 27 orbits before they merged. There's another detection from October 2015, but they're less certain about that when they're not claiming anything. A lot of you may have seen, oh, without the mouse going, I don't know if I get this to go or not. Oh, there it goes. I may have seen this illustration from the internet showing the merger of two black holes. And this is one they released at the time of the announcement of the gravity wave detection. The thing is, though, all that little motion you saw around the periphery of the star stuff in the background, that's not actually gravitational waves, it's gravitational lens effect. It's sort of indirectly related. All right. Who cares? Really? Well, wonderful. Okay, I'll do the best I can to find that. All right, this is an expression I hear all the time. It opens a new window on the universe. I remember college people talking about the discovery of pulsars and saying that. And as a skeptical college student, I said, you gotta be kidding me. What does that really mean? This time, I think we really mean it. It's a whole other way to see the universe. We've been limited to the electromagnetic spectrum. This is something else. With the electromagnetic spectrum, we never had any idea that two massive black holes merged. But, it's about a year ago, September. We had no idea. We're going to be detecting events in other galaxies that otherwise would go undetected. So you can test your ideas, certainly. And how many massive black holes are there anyway? As I get to the end of today's talk, you're going to see that's an important question. You know, I hate to say this, sounds a cornball, but you can expect the unexpected. Guaranteed. We've opened up another window. Now, exciting that is, I'm out of time on that topic. We're on to the next one. How many moons does the Earth have? Sort of, kind of, too. If you stretch the definition of a moon. This is asteroid, and you can go to 2016 HO3, is a companion of Earth in space. Basically, it orbits the sun, and its orbit is very similar to the Earth's orbit. So it gravitationally interacts not just with the sun, but with the Earth. And there's a kind of a strange dance that goes on. But technically, it's not considered a moon of the Earth. They can argue whether that's right or not, but I'm just telling you. Let me see if I can get this video to run. This is from Jet Propulsion Laboratory. There we go. The orbit of the Earth is in blue, the asteroids in yellow, and the Earth's going in and out at a distance from the sun because we're actually going around the orbit. You're seeing the ellipticity of the Earth's orbit there. And this is going to go on for possibly another century or more. And no, it's not going to hit. And you have some sizes. Never gets closer than about 9 million miles. And Jet Propulsion Laboratory did the whole thing. We've been talking a long time in astronomy in recent years about there being flowing water on Mars today. Now we know there was a lot of it in the ancient past, but today. Well, and I talked a lot about that last year. It's fading away, more evidence. So let me start off with the Astro update on this topic from last year. Show you what I showed you last year. Am I correcting what I said? Yep. By the way, that's why science works. Am I embarrassed? Not least. Fessing up to a mistake? Think about that. That doesn't happen much these days. There are dark streaks seen on Mars from orbital craft called recurring slope lineae, RSL. And you can see the comment there where they show up on slopes, steep slopes, and they have seasonal patterns. They come and go with seasons. And the thinking was that underground water of some sort was involved, and because these things appear when things are warmer on Mars in those latitudes, and so maybe there's some ice beneath the dusty surface that goes at least a little bit to liquid, probably a salty liquid, and that flows down and distorts, discolors the ground until it evaporates or something. So, water soaked in salts. Actually, that presence was confirmed. That's still true. Using refracting spectrometry from Earth orbit, we can tell that, in fact, there's some. It's more like saying the salt has a bit of water in it rather than saying water has some salt in it. But nevertheless, this is the time lapse. Watch the dates up near the top. And you can see those dark marks come and go. So I presented this last time and said, see, there's flowing water on Mars. I mean, it doesn't last long or go very far, but geez, there's still something there today. Problem. This is this year. We find these everywhere, even near the tops of mountains. Hard to believe a water aquifer is going all those different elevations. It's just not logical. Still need a source of water, and so the thinking is it's from the atmosphere. It's being absorbed. And that's doing these tricks of making those streaks. Well, the trouble is, that requires a pretty humid atmosphere. We barely have an atmosphere, let alone a humid one. So, confusion reigns on this right now, what's going on. Stand by, it gets worse. I think worse. You may have seen these things before, the slope of a crater, you see those dark gullies that have been carved there running downhill. Well, that looks like water erosion. And those gullies, if you look at them very carefully over time, they seem to show some changes. So the thinking is that there must at times be some water, at least for a short stretch, running down, carrying down some, you know, gravel and soil with it, and carving these things a little bit differently over time. That was the thinking. Probably not, it turns out. Spectral analysis. The details in those gullies, and that took a while to get, showed no indication of any hydrated minerals. In other words, there's absolutely no evidence that water has ever flowed in them. So now we're thinking maybe this has something to do with sublimation of carbon dioxide. Sort of like the way ice on Earth creates potholes in the streets. Maybe. Looking for another answer there. Does that mean Mars doesn't have any water? It never did? No, not at all. In fact, again, it's ancient history, lots of water, and now it appears that it was on the planet at least a billion years longer than we first thought. And if you're a fan for Martian life, you should be cheering at that. Yeah. There is evidence from the Mars Reconnaissance Orbiter, for instance, of actually chains of ancient lakes. One was at least is estimated to be as large as Lake Ontario, Great Lakes. So there was once a lot of water. Another study, which I didn't have time to put in, but I'll just mention briefly, seems to think they see signs of where tsunamis came across and hit shorelines, probably from big, large impacts of meteors. Then there's just some pretty pictures. We've got Curiosity rover, as you know, it's sitting there in Gale Crater. It's been operating beautifully. But some of these images, I won't even bother with the science, just look. Some of these look like even Arizona. And you might notice the layering in the rocks. That's water. That's a product of water. Things, particles separating out and being compacted. There's a lot of dust. This is right at the base of the peak, the central mountain peak in Gale Crater. And this one, look very carefully. Let's see if I can get this fired up here. You can see here the crater wall in the distance. Very hazy view, it's hard to see it. But that's the distance wall of the crater. Okay. On to Ceres. You remember this one? Largest asteroid. Well, you know, I always thought of asteroids as being just dumb rocks. That's not where the dumb was. It's us. You remember those bright spots? Okay. In the bottom of this crater, wasn't clear what they were in the beginning, but a lot of sunlight. Thought it was made of ice, water ice, that somehow was broken to the surface, maybe by an impact or something. Turns out, now that we've gotten the Dawn spacecraft into a lower orbit, so its spectrometer can focus on a narrow enough field so it can look at just the ice, or what you think might be ice, it turns out it's not. It's a salt. But this salt on Earth is usually the result of an evaporated ocean. Now, you know, let's maybe get this straight. This thing's 600 miles across and had an ocean. No, we're still processing this. But that's what it's telling. By the way, these aren't the only spots like that. There's others in the series. These are just the most obvious ones. Then there's the other strange problem. If you do a crater count, craters aren't produced by impacts of things from space. And you can look at things throughout the solar system and how they've been impacted, and you get a range of crater sizes. And so you usually get a distribution. You always get a certain number in each size range. Ceres, while it has a few big craters, it's lacking them mostly. The other way you get rid of craters that we know of is some kind of erosion process, but how can you have erosion selectively only work on big craters? Again, we don't know what we're looking at here. Oh, and then there's this thing, which is probably an ice volcano. Yeah, in fact, we'll see the profile. It's 13,000 feet high, 11 miles at its base. Half the size of Mount Everest. And we think it's all a product of ices coming up in a Cairo type eruption. We've thought about these things existing before, but this is the first time we've really seen them convincingly. Juno got to Jupiter. Yeah. What's this all about? Have you been to Jupiter before? I mean, in fact, a lot. We have all kinds of pictures. I'm giving you the kind of questions you get from an audience or somebody who's skeptical of what we spend on this stuff. Why would you go there again? Because there's something amiss in our understanding of Jupiter, big time. I don't know if you know this or not, but every textbook, you know, shows the interior slice, the inside of Jupiter. And they show this rocky core, and then they show different layers and all that kind of stuff. I hope you know that's all guessing. In fact, there's many planetary scientists will tell you they don't think there's a core. It's not a rocky core. It may not exist. Oh, there's another problem. Way back when, we dropped a space probe into the atmosphere, and it was to detect water. Water is really important because we think that's how Jupiter got to be Jupiter. When the solar system was a young solar system, we had this nice big disk of material going around the proto-sun, and where things could condense and get bigger, they did. But out there, outer, about more than 5 AU from the sun, the way you build things big out there is you can get at least a rocky core Earth size, and it has enough gravity that it can attract the gases and water. And you get the water, it gives you more mass, and then you can really hang on to things like hydrogen. So, the models all say planets like Jupiter should have lots and lots of water. That probe we dropped in didn't find any. Didn't last very long, though. It got crushed by the pressure. By the way, we've been looking for signs of water in big exoplanets. So far, haven't found any. So we're getting a little bugged about what we think we know. Now, here's the orbit. They're coming in over the poles. The reason being is that Jupiter is a hellish radiation field. And if you come in the equatorial plane, you're going to be in trouble. There are some of these trapped regions here. This is a donut shape, actually, on both sides. And you don't want to cut through here because it'll fry all the electronics. So we skip the donut and come in through the top, go out the bottom. And we get as close as we can to the surface of Jupiter. Because using that with the instruments on board, we can probe for water. But if you want to be a high-resolution probe of where it is inside, you've got to be really close. Your field of view and your detector is narrow, and your pixels are small. You get a better idea of what's inside. Now, the way they're doing this is Jupiter is its internal heat. You may remember that. It actually is still giving off energy, possibly from its formation or whatever, or its slow contraction. But the point is, that energy includes microwaves. Yeah, that stuff in your oven at home. Microwaves. But microwaves don't penetrate through water terribly well. So if you can go around and scan what you're seeing beneath the spacecraft each time in these different microwave wavelengths, you can tell by what you don't pick up where it's being absorbed. In fact, by picking different wavelengths of microwave energy, you can decide what depth you're looking at in the atmosphere of Jupiter, and decide where the water clouds are, and ammonia clouds, and so on. That's what's going on now. Now, let me back up half a sec here. We think this is only going to last maybe 30 orbits. Because with every time it's passed through close to Jupiter, the electronics are getting fried a little bit by the radiation each time. Eventually, the self-error-correcting algorithms inside aren't going to be able to handle it anymore. And this thing's going to essentially lose its brain. But until then, we're going to collect all the data we can. And this is a view over the pole of Jupiter. We've never seen it from this angle before. We get kind of slanting views from, you know, the orbiters and Voyager and things like that. But this is actually looking down at the poles. You notice all the belts and zones are gone. All you see is these swirly areas. So the atmospheric structure is quite, and you don't see, by the way, a hexagon like you do see on Saturn. A lot of interesting stuff to come. We've only made one pass so far. Water geysers on Europa. We thought there was a lot of water on Europa. We thought that for a long time, but now there's evidence there's actually geysers. You see in that picture how Europa, probably seen from Earth, will occasionally go across in front of Jupiter. Those are transits, and amateur astronomers, me too for that matter, enjoy watching those on occasion. It's you know, seeing something real happening in front of you. But when you see that thing in profile, there's been some indication that there's a little bit extra something down below there at about 7 o'clock. And when you do the processing of subtracting images, well, again, looks like there's a little something down there about 7 o'clock. It looks like it could be water. Well, if that's true, if it has geysers, you know, like some of the other moons do, that might mean that sampling that underground, under ice, I should say, ocean, might be easier to do than we hoped, if that's for real. But as you can see, it's right on the noise level. It's very tall. Then we have Rosetta, orbiting this old, poor, beat-up, funny-looking comet. Its mission, 12-year mission, has ended. The comet itself orbits the sun every 6.4 years. The closest it gets to the sun is about 1.2 AUs and goes out over 5. And the Rosetta just followed it around its orbit around the sun. Okay, cool. Well, one of the things it detected going through all that stuff that's venting, it's got a composition of the water vapor coming off. And to make a long story short, its isotopic abundance, the heavy water, normal water, is goofed up. It doesn't compare to Earth at all. We thought maybe comets were the source of the water, the you'll have on the Earth, because water in our models is tough for the Earth to have it after it's formed. The Earth was too hot at that point. So they thought, well, later collisions of comets brought it, but we consistently show that comets, their water's got the wrong isotopic ratio, and there's no way to change that. So, as a different source. There's the lander. They found it. Remember that bounced and all that kind of stuff? And lost track of it. And you can see it's lying on its side. It's in shadow. And, yeah, it's a good attempt. And they also may note that they finally took Rosetta itself and decided to end the mission by letting it fall into the comet. Now, why did they end the mission? Well, it's getting further and further from the sun now. The comet is going around the sun, it's going further out. Signals are getting weaker. The activity in the comet is going to be dwindling. And the real kicker is, it's going to be sort of behind the sun, it seems, from the Earth for quite some time. That's not too good for transmission, so time to end. So they did a slow descent. It's a height of 16 kilometers. That's hard to believe that's a comet. You know, I don't know, as a kid, I always thought these looked like ice cubes. I really did. Oh, maybe a smidge of dirt on it or something, you know. Now here you see mountains and ridges and all kinds of, and boulders that have rolled downhill, whatever way down is. Okay, that's 16 kilometers, 9 meters. Now you can see that, you know, stones, or what I call those stones, are probably pieces of ice. And there's the last blurry picture at impact. The lander, or I should say Rosetta, was given instructions, very simply, once you get down, even if you're still alive, don't call home anymore. We're not going to listen. And the mission's way over. So no, we're not going to, they're not listening. See, it's still kicking around. Could be, but end is end. Probably in the last year, the thing that still dominates everything is Pluto. This was supposed to be boring, folks. This was supposed to be a dead world. Nothing would change. It was going to be an ice cube. In fact, a really, really cold one at that. You know how we have this heart-shaped region on Pluto, which is called Tombaugh. I'm looking for the button here. Now, anyway, you notice it's been here. And this left half is a different color than the right half. Well, it also has a little different composition. And that right half lacks there's not a single impact crater. Not one. It's ever been seen. Impact craters still hit planets today. They hit the Earth. We've seen asteroids even in the last couple of years hit Jupiter. It still goes on. How can you not have at least something had hit that? And in fact, the region that Pluto's in, we would expect even more. The only way that can happen is somehow it's getting replaced, smoothed over, cleaned up. Something's going on to erase the impacts. We see impacts elsewhere on Pluto, but not there. So, conservatively, the area in there is less than 500 million years old. I know that's a huge length of time, it sounds like, because we're humans, and we judge time by a human lifetime. That's stupid. We shouldn't do that. 500 million years for the universe is nothing. It's a time. Again, this area, I don't know why you can see on the screen, because I'm not seeing my monitor terribly well, but I'll turn around and have a look. This is very projector dependent, how well it looks. Oh, it's not bad. You see these features in here? Now, this is ice. Not water ice. Nitrogen. The stuff you're breathing right now, frozen to the ground. Also, what you're breathing is nitrogen. Frozen to the ground, N2. And those shapes look like polygons and stuff. We think they're the tops of literally bubbles coming up from the interior. This is like a very slow and cold boiling pot of frozen nitrogen. Those are the tops of the convection cells. This fits the models for this perfectly. The models even predict the sizes of those cells. The only question is, where is the heat coming from? Why is it still hot down in the middle? Radioactive decay, probably. Those cells are 10, 30 miles across. Now, part of the reason this works is, I say it's frozen nitrogen. Nitrogen, when it's, you and I have probably never seen frozen. I've seen liquid nitrogen. I've never seen frozen solid nitrogen. It turns out it's not hard like you think. It has more of the consistency of toothpaste. So that's why that can be a boiling pot. And you could have things floating in there so long as they're less dense than this toothpaste, right? Or more, as long as they're less dense, they'll float. Water does that. Frozen water. There's a whole chain of mountains. I don't know how well you can see that picture because I couldn't find a bigger version of this one. I've enlarged it there. But off the edge, there's a whole place where it looks like pieces of, I'll call quotation marks, the crust, which is ice, water ice, is broken off. They become icebergs and they kind of float downhill. But those are small mountains floating in a sea of frozen nitrogen. No, there's no place else in the solar system that does this, even though they're almost as cold. This looks nothing like the ice moons of Jupiter or Saturn. This is just totally unique. And by the way, it hasn't always apparently been so cold. That looks like a frozen lake. About 20 miles on this longer dimension. Now, because of Pluto's tipped axis of 120 degrees, and it's very elliptical orbit, the temperatures can range quite a bit. Mostly the atmospheric pressures we're interested in. It's something to stay liquid any length of time. But there should be times when it's 10,000 times higher than it is now. Sounds impressive, but 10,000 times something close to zero doesn't give you a lot. But, All right. And is there still liquid water in there? This is one of the craziest ideas from Pluto. It appears, now I'm not a geologist, I can't look at that picture and tell you this, but from scans and pictures like this around the planet, the hemisphere we studied anyway, it looks like, in fact, it has expanded, not contracted, at the time. And one thing that will expand is water, liquid, as it freezes. Is there a layer of water down there that is slowly freezing, forcing the planet to stretch and grow? This is one of the current pictures. Working model. It's a theory. It needs testing. Yeah, maybe next year I'll tell you it's wrong. Maybe not. Very quickly, there's a nice volcano. If that's what we think that is, straight down at it. Not nearly as convincing the case as we can make, though, for Ceres. All right, this is the big one, right? Planet 9. Is there a ninth planet? I'm not talking about Pluto. I'm talking about another significant planet. I've heard many times, astronomers have discovered a new planet. No. We have reasons to suspect there's one, but until I see a picture of one with the orbit, I don't buy it yet. But here's the evidence. It all comes from simulations and doing dynamics. There's about a dozen objects, these are icy objects, like Pluto, that orbit at least 150 AU from the Sun, never get closer than 50 AU. Pluto, at its farthest distance from the Sun, is 50. So these start there and go out. About a dozen of those. Now, their closest point to the Sun, perihelia, are all clustered in the ecliptic plane, the plane of the Earth's orbit. No good reason for them to do that. And they're all moving the same direction, the same time, the same way at that time period, going from south to north. The six most distant ones have almost the same orientation on the orbits. Now, if you believe that this all kind of being randomly generated by the gravitational effects of all things in the solar system, there's only a 0.007% probability that this occurred by random chance. So in other words, it looks like that. They're all on this picture to one side. And if you look in the middle, you see kind of that bright ball for the sun. Actually, Pluto's orbit's inside that. These are quite a ways out. Getting things to orbit with these strange elliptical orbits arranged that way requires something with gravitational force affecting them. So, the only way you treat this is with simulations. When you were in school at some point, you probably encountered in some elementary physical science class, Newton's law of gravity, you know, gm1 m2 over d distance squared. Okay. And you can figure out how these things would pull on each other, and you get an orbit, you think. Well, the ugly truth is, all that only works when you have no more than two objects. As soon as you add a third, we're in trouble. The first thing we do is we restrict the three-body problem. We pretend the third one doesn't have any mass. It just reacts to the other two. And that's how we handle binary stars and things, matter flowing in binary star systems. But if you went to a solar system, it's n-body. What you have to do is do a lot of time steps in the computer, just give you a sense of this. Start with object one, whatever it is, could be an asteroid, could be the Earth, could be the moon of Mars, and say, okay, at this time, what's the gravitational pull of everything in the solar system right now, at that time step on the object, add it all up as a vector, figure out which way it's going to pull it and make it move. All right, now do the next object. And how many objects are you going to do in your model? That's how much computer time you have. So you might do 1,000 objects. All the major planets, of course, but then you got to do other small things. Then you time the still, let everything move a little bit, and redo the whole computation again. This is very, very computer intensive, takes lots of time, and so if you want to simulate, say, 1,000 years or 1,000,000 years of history, future history of the solar system, it takes a lot of crunching. Which means you don't do it very long. Simulations are all limited. So, to tell you the truth, we don't know if the solar system long-term is even stable. In fact, we're quite certain it probably isn't. We can't do those calculations very well. Well, here's what we come up with. I shouldn't say we, Chalmers Brown, comes up with for this other planet. It's no closer to the sun than 300 astronomical units. So it's a long way out. It's 10 times the mass of the Earth. This is a significant planet. 2 to 4 times the Earth's diameter. In fact, by modern terminology, it's now what would be called a super-Earth from what we've seen in exoplanets. Averages about 700 AU from the sun. It's got an elliptical orbit. Orbital period takes 10,000 to 20,000 years. That's why you didn't see it buzz the neighborhood lately. It's a long time. That's where it is. It has enough gravitational strength, these other objects are much smaller, that they're reacting to it. It's mixing the pot. If I turn this 90 degrees so you can see it in profile, that's another way it looks. Do we know for sure it exists? Nope. Are people looking? Yep. Are they going to find it anytime soon? Nope. Not likely. Because, first of all, it's going to be faint, and it's not going to move a lot, so it's going to be tough to pick it up. And where do you look? Well, we've got the general idea, but when you only know, any of you use telescopes, I tell you, I want you to find a comet, and by the way, it's over there in the eastern sky someplace. Good luck. It's not easy. Proxima Centauri. That's actually the closest star to the sun. Oh yeah, which one is it? Proxima Centauri. You thought it was Alpha Centauri. Alpha Centauri is a triple system, three stars. And Proxima is actually closer than the other two. It also happens to be, here's a hint, a red dwarf star. Anything in that picture look a little red? Kind of just to the right of center. Bill Keel, a colleague, took this picture. Not easy to see. Why am I bringing it up? It has a planet. And so it's the closest planetary system, exoplanetary system to the Earth. 4.22 light years. The planet's about 1.3 times the mass of the Earth, orbiting every 11 days. And so that makes the media, of course, go nuts with these pictures. And immediately speculating how it is Earth-like. Okay, I'll give you the facts. It orbits that star only 5% as far as we do our sun. 5% of an astronomical unit. That's okay, because Proxima Centauri is a red dwarfish star, so it's not very luminous, it's not very hot, and you can be closer to it and still have liquid water. Oh, one problem. Proxima Centauri, like all small red dwarf stars, flares. So occasionally that planet gets barbecued. Nevertheless, the magnetic field, if it has one, it can survive. You notice there's a lot of ifs in this. So let's send a space probe there and check it out. This has been proposed, seriously, by Yuri Milner, a Russian billionaire, Mark Zuckerberg, and Stephen Hawking. They're proposing sending a space probe, Alpha Centauri. This thing's going to get to 20% the speed of light, and it'll get there in 20 years. 20 years? Man, too bad. Oh, one problem. Accelerate anything to 20% speed of light requires a lot of energy, unless the thing you're accelerating is not very big. The space probe is about the size of a postage stamp. It's a piece of silicon, all electronic circuitry built into it, even a camera, and they're going to accelerate it out with light laser beams. This is now under study, and Milner's come up with $100 million out of his pocket to fund the study. So I don't think you're going to see this launched anytime soon, but the idea was, one of the ideas is you take a bunch of these, produce them, take them up to Earth orbit, and in a conventional rocket, kind of spew them out and then blast them with the lasers from the ground. I've often wondered what happens to our own atmosphere in birds when you blast the atmosphere with lasers. Like, never mind. 40 light years away, we have three potentially habitable planets around a star. Again, this is a cool M star. And there's this orbital configuration. We got two in close, which are going to be kind of toasty, maybe Venus-like, and a third one, which could possibly be Earth-like, be habitable, if it has an atmosphere and water. But some of these, the two inner ones, are only like a hundredth, a tenth and a hundredth solar of an astronomical unit. Very close. Then, of course, you know about this incredible scientific breakthrough. You heard about this one, didn't you? Yeah, also known as Tabby's star. This is a fairly ordinary, normal-looking star. It should never change its brightness. At least in a human lifetime, should be nice and constant. And it's doing funny stuff. This happened to be in the field of view of the Kepler Space Telescope. And Kepler found these dips. Now, dips normally, for Kepler, means the transit of a planet. They're not planets, they're just dipping 20% in some cases. That's not a planet. And then, if you see over there on the right edge there, in the yellow area, which also is enlarged in the three boxes below, how erratic it is. And so the idea was, someone said, what we're seeing is things getting dim because these aliens are building this Dyson sphere around it. Or, you don't want to go there, maybe there's a whole swarm of comets falling in. My reaction to that is, boy, how fortunate is that that we happen to catch that event? Which doesn't seem too likely, considering now we've discovered the star has been gradually dimming over the last 100 years. There's other things going on. And to make it even less likely, we found another one. That didn't get any news in the media at all. There's another one. Doing the same goofy things. We don't know what this is. More later. Most powerful supernova ever recorded. Very far away, so it's not too bright. You see before and after picture there. In fact, its estimated distance is 2.8 billion light years. At peak brightness, this is 200 times brighter than a typical Type 1A supernova. And Type 1A is the brightest supernova. It's also twice the brightness of the previous record holder. Now, and it shows no hydrogen in the spectrum. That's a big puzzle. That usually is a sign that a white dwarf collapsed. It's a supernova. A white dwarf cannot give you this kind of energy output. Just can't. Physically impossible. There's some curves. Our new supernova is the top one. The vertical axis is brightness, and we got just time going across. The vertical axis is logarithmic. Watch that. So the black one is roughly 10 times brighter than that blue curve below it. That's the great things about a logarithmic scale. So they thought, no, maybe it's a magnetar. What that is a very, very, very dense neutron star, of course, but it has an incredibly strong magnetic field, which holds a lot of energy, and you're squishing this thing down, and you got the rotation energy and the magnetic energy, and that's how we can account for it. Now you do the calculations. Magnetars have been used to explain almost everything in the last 10 years that we can't handle. Need more energy? Oh, just invoke one of those. No evidence for it, we'll just abuse it. It turns out that doesn't work either. This is stronger than that. Especially since it decided to get brighter again. Time on this axis and versus brightness. Brightness up, dim is down, just like you expect, even with a magnitude scale. But if you look at the blues and the green dots, that's visible light. And you see, well, it got bright there on the left, and then peaked and came on down with time, like it's supposed to. The reds and the yellow in there, and some other shade of blue, unfortunately, those are in the ultraviolet wavelengths. You see, it was very bright for a bit in UV, came crashing down, and around, 75 days or so, it decided to get brighter again. That's a big deal. This curve up here is a lot of extra energy. So that blue, most of the thinking we have, ideas we had is what this thing is. That's cool. Black holes, they sometimes wander, it turns out. We didn't know this. I'm talking about massive black holes. You know, like the ones we have in the centers of Milky Way, galaxies like the Milky Way? We always thought once you got them in there, they stay put. Here's a picture, I forget the star cluster, but if you look carefully at the yellow, now the box there on the left, let me just enlarge it. Save some time. That apparently is a black hole. About 100,000 times the mass of the sun. It's not a huge black hole, but it's apparently drifting out of the galaxy. Maybe it has something to do with a collision, another galaxy. Or maybe we're crazy. I don't know. Black holes in the centers of galaxies can do some remarkable things. This is just one picture. An enormous black hole blast. And in the center there, you see a bluish object which is labeled supermassive black hole. That's the core of a galaxy. This is not visible light, by the way. The blue stuff is X-ray, and the red stuff is radio. So we don't even have visible light in this picture to speak of. And what you see are jets coming out, one to the right. There's one to the left, too, but it's harder to see. There's a black hole buried in the center of that galaxy, which is, I can't remember the name now, Victor A. And those jets are streaming out at a good fraction of the speed of light, fires a lot of energy, and creating these big red radio lobes out there. And on the extreme right side there, you see this bright spot. That's the shock wave when it hits interstellar intergalactic material. By the way, the jet's 300,000 light years long. That galaxy, that fuzzy little quirky thing in the middle, is 99.9% dark matter. We know this, it's in the coma cluster of galaxies. We know this because we have some idea of the motions of the stars. And frankly, we don't see enough. We count the stars up, there's not enough in there to create enough gravity to keep them stars as they move from spilling off into space. Or even to keep it from being pulled apart by the other galaxies in this galaxy cluster, which you can't see very well in this picture, but they're there. And the only way you can account for it is if that galaxy, which is not very bright, is almost entirely dark matter. And the real question, for me anyway, is how did that ever happen? Don't know. Last topic. dark matter creating black holes. Well, that was suggested almost in the first 30 seconds of discovery of dark matter. Maybe less than 30 seconds. It was dismissed for the following reasons. It has been for decades now. Very simple, is that black holes tend to eat. And when stuff's drawn in, it tends to get hot, there's a lot of energy, and so black holes, at least the region around them, is anything but quiet and faint. So we should see these all over the place, so that wouldn't account for the dark matter. Kashlinsky, an astrophysicist at Goddard, JPL, I think it's Goddard, has come up with another calculations to show, wait, you jumped the gun. If you go back to the Big Bang, shortly thereafter, we had a universe of very high densities. And some of this material would have gotten, in small regions at least, highly compressed. And would produce what we call primordial black holes. Lots of them. And they'd still be there today. The universe got expanded out, but they're still there. And by the way, each one of those would have a mass of about 30 solar masses. Remember that number 30? Gravitational wave detection? They were both from about 30. He's suggesting that what was actually seen there was the merger of two of these things that were produced in the Big Bang itself. And that galaxies, whether we see them or not, are all embedded in clouds of 30 mass solar black holes. And he said, well, why aren't we detecting them? Oh, we are. If you look at, he claims, if you look at the background radiation, the microwave background radiation, of course, but there's also excess in infrared and some X-ray background. Again, calculation. Yeah, they are feeding light late, and that's what that's coming from. We'll have to wait and see. Now, be careful. I want to make sure you understand what I'm not saying. I am not saying this is right. I am not saying they understand what dark matter is. Far from it. This idea is I should be, as a scientist, I'm skeptical. But then again, until it's really proven to be goofy, totally goofy, we have to consider it. I'm 3 minutes over. Apologize. But you got here late. Questions? Because I can't see you. Yeah, I think I... There's convection and glacier flows. There's two things going on. Glaciers, convection flows bring, it's like a boiling pot. Stuff will come up to the top, but don't think of liquid too much. It's actually more solid. Stuff comes up to the top and then sinks again. So if there's stuff down on the surface, it's going to get drawn down. Also, the whole surface is flowing to one side, like a conveyor belt. And so that is causing things to disappear. Now, I'm gesturing like I know what I'm talking about. I don't know anyone totally knows what we're talking about. We're still trying to figure this out, but that's the going idea. I don't know if I answered your question or not. I hope I did. Now, others? Yeah.
Have you heard any updates on Juno's thruster problems?
No.
Okay. They had a valve problem. They weren't sure they were going to get
into lower
orbit.
Oh, that's right.
Yeah.
Don't mess those up, for sure. Does anyone know if the European Space Agency actually heard from the lander?
No, yes? Said
the parachute
got it early.
The what?
The parachute got it early.
Well, they've not had a good luck of landing things lately. The Leia lander on the Philae lander had trouble too. I can't put him down. We had a lot of problems with Mars ourselves. Other things?
Maybe just one more question.
I don't have a good answer for you. I'm not a geologist. That hurts me a lot to answer that question. Other than the fact of looking at some of the literature, I hesitate to say that because if you get into too much too technical, you get lost, and your goal is lost trying to get over here. But no, I other than watching things like the webpage, or New Horizons, where they do not update that once in a while. That's what I've watched.
Thank you.
That was it.
Dr. Kazak, I know I speak for everyone here. I really enjoy your talks. I know that we all enjoy the talks. It's one of my favorite things about the conference. I really look forward to it. So we really appreciate you taking the time to put it together.
I'll even thank Gary.